I've aspired to try to talk about violence and its consequences. I've tried to talk about the fact that history is made up of people, that there are winners and losers, that there is a price to be paid, and that nothing happens absent its resonance and its consequences. Those films that I have objected to personally or politically are those that seem to objectify its participants and exploit the violence and exploit war to suggest that it exists without political context and without human consequence.
Not surprisingly, the Pentagon refused to cooperate on Edward Zwick's film, The Siege. Any aspect of the script that deals with military ethics, the behavior of soldiers and officers in times of peace and war, is the object of particular scrutiny by the liaison officers who look at the scripts proposed by the studios. There are many subjects and themes that draw their attention, and the different possible reasons for denying cooperation constantly evolve.
Often, the special assistant to the Secretary of Defense for entertainment media will receive a script concurrently with my office. I'll do a sort of peripheral read where I just kind of get the main points and see where does it have the Army. And that's the first thing I look for, is the first specific Army or military mention. And I'll sort of make notes, okay, we're here. The second time I'll go through and read it with a bit more critical eye. How would that soldier really behave in that situation? What sort of language is the soldier using? How is the soldier viewed by the civilians in the picture? What is the mood of the piece? And I go by it step by step until I can get through it, and it'll be a script similar to this one that's full of notes.
First of all, when we look at scripts, you know, are we conducting damage control? And the answer is absolutely. It's not my role here to vilify the armed forces, because I'm a believer of the armed forces. I wouldn't be in this job if I didn't. And my colleagues feel the same way. Those who are in the military obviously are adherents, otherwise they would vote with their feet and quit. So we are all very much of the opinion that the military is an institution for the betterment of the United States. So any picture that's contrary to that fundamental premise is going to be a problem for us.
I just wonder how many of the 600 Americans that have been killed in Iraq joined the military because they saw some movie when they were a kid that they'd say, oh, I want to join the military. I saw this movie and it looks great. How many of the dead 600 Americans joined the military because of some movie that they saw, not knowing that the military was the ones that were behind the scenes manipulating the content of the script to make the military look better than it really was? Once they got to Iraq, it was too late. You know, it wasn't all so glamorous over there.
When you use the military for propaganda, and the American public sees it all the time, the sensitivity to what's real and what's not real is lost. And because our movies are shipped around the world and everybody sees them around the world, that sensitivity may be going elsewhere. And what happens when that takes place is that when a life is taken, you care a little less. When you lose somebody, you care a little, oh, that's war. You know, we get this sort of very tough attitude. And I'm afraid that's what the movies are doing.
This is the Windtalker script, the original script, and this is page 51 is the character of the dentist. And the description says, bent over a dead Japanese soldier doing what he does, relieving the dead of the gold in their mouth. And then the dialogue for the dentist is, come to Papa. The dentist twists his bayonet, struggles to get the gold nugget out of the corpse's teeth, sees Helmstead and the rest of the second assault coming to the slope. Well, this was a big problem for the Pentagon. They didn't want anything like this in the movie. This is an internal memo from the Marine Corps Film Office, Captain Matt Morgan, to Phil Stroob, saying, page 51, the dentist digs gold from the jaws of corpses. This has to go. The activity is unmarine. And Phil Stroob, his boss at the Pentagon, wrote back, stealing gold teeth. Yep, has to go. The dentist character displays distinctly unmarine behavior. He is, in fact, committing an atrocity. Well, they don't want that shown in a film that they're cooperating with. So the producers agreed that they would take it out. So the entire character, the dentist, was eliminated from the film. It's no longer in there. As we see from the film, the real actual footage, Marines really did this during World War II. There is actual footage of a Marine with a pair of pliers pulling the gold teeth out of dead Japanese soldiers' mouth. This is the real face of war, not the idealized, heroic version that the Pentagon wants to project. My objection is not to filmmakers altering history. Filmmakers, art is manipulable, and filmmakers can say whatever they want. They can say something that's absolutely false. But when the military starts dictating the content of art and saying what history is and their idea of history, well, we know that's completely false. And one of the great examples is what they tried to do with the film 13 Days. The filmmakers are trying to stick very close to real history. They had the actual Kennedy. Before Nixon was taping in the White House, Kennedy was taping in the White House. And we can actually hear at the John F. Kennedy Library website, you can listen to the actual tape recordings that Kennedy was having during the Cuban Missile Crisis. The other option, that was not good enough for the military. They did not want a real picture of what the military was advising, which would have taken us down the path of World War III. They wanted a much more sanitized version, and they would not assist Kevin Costner and Peter Allman and the producers of 13 Days because it showed too much the real history, the true facts of what happened.
But if launched, those missiles from Cuba would kill a lot of Americans. The very presence of those missiles gives the Soviets first strike capability. Those missiles make a nuclear exchange more likely. And that is why I'm being such a pain in the ass about destroying them and destroying them immediately. Hell, even Mac agrees. And, sir, given your own statements about Cuba, I think a blockade or a bunch of political talk would be considered by a lot of our friends and neutrals as a pretty weak response. I suspect that many of our own citizens might feel the same way. You're in a pretty bad fix, Mr. President. What did you say? You're in a pretty bad fix.
Well, maybe you haven't noticed you're in it with me. Now, General, what are the Soviets going to do when we attack?
Nothing.
Nothing?
Nothing. Because the only alternative open to them is one they can't choose.
You know, they're not just missiles we're going to be destroying, General. If we kill Soviet soldiers, they're going to respond. I mean, how would we respond? If they killed ours, no, they're going to do something, General. I can promise you that.
Those goddamn Kennedys are going to destroy this country if we don't do something about this.
There's little to say about 13 Days. We met with the filmmakers. We walked around the building a little bit. We chatted. I pointed out to them that the script was... I guess they weren't writing the script at that point. I'm not quite sure. I don't remember exactly where we were. I guess at that point they hadn't written the script yet. And I had discussion with the director, and I think he conceded that he was going to take some artistic liberties with history, which is not surprising. That's what everybody does. But when we got the script, we found that it was just impossible. It was so unrealistic. And we sort of did this... you know, my historian is smarter than your historian, and we kind of went back and forth, and they insisted that things had happened that my historian said did not happen, and particularly over some of the portrayals of McNamara and his relationship with the whole White House versus the military. I mean, we felt that the purpose of the military in 13 Days was to serve as a thuggish, malign presence against which the Kennedys could glow in contrast.
This is a letter from Phil Strube to the producers of 13 Days from July 1998, where they told them that they're not going to give them assistance for this film. They're saying that they won't help them because both General LeMay and General Taylor are depicted in a negative and inauthentic way as unintelligent and bellicose. But in fact, that's exactly what they were. The two generals were very belligerent. They wanted to go to war. They wanted to attack Cuba. The record is clear on that because they have tapes showing it.